According to the CIA's charter, agents cannot engage in secret operations of any kind within the countries of the UK, Australia, Canada, and New Zealand without the explicit prior approval of the host government. Yet not even this most basic tenet has been upheld. The coup against Gough Whitlam's Labour government in Australia in 1972 exposes a wide variety of dirty tricks used by intelligence agencies to undermine democracy. In Australia in 1972, a Labour government was elected for the first time in 23 years. It would be brought down in a de facto coup d'etat conducted by the CIA in liaison with Britain's MI6 and, most shockingly, Australia's own intelligence services. Since assuming power in Australia, Whitlam's Labour government had enacted a series of reforms. These included raises in wages, pensions, and unemployment benefits, free national health care, equal pay for women, the abolishment of tuition fees, new services for Aboriginal peoples, and the replacement of God Save the Queen with Australia's own national anthem. Most disturbing to Washington, however, was the withdrawal of Australian troops from Vietnam, the support of Palestinian rights, and the proposal of an Indian Ocean zone of peace. Worst of all, Whitlam hinted that he might shut down a number of American military bases, including Pine Gap. When CIA Director William Colby petitioned his counterpart at MI6, Sir Maurice Oldfield, for help, he stressed that Australia was traditionally Britain's domain, and that if Pine Gap were closed, the alliance would be blinded strategically. Unbeknownst to Australia's new Prime Minister, the Australian Security Intelligence Organization had not only been working closely with the CIA, they had been illegally passing on dossiers concerning every member of the Labour Party, as well as union leaders, peace activists, and other Australian citizens. A slush fund was set up to provide money to both opposition parties via the Nugenhand Bank, a CIA front company. This was followed up by a promise to the main opposition Liberal Party of unlimited funds.
In recent years, there have been charges from time to time that the CIA has involved itself in illegal activities. Some of the most bizarre to date involve a bank in Australia known as Nugenhand. And tonight, Gary Shepherd has a report.
When the Nugenhand Bank of Sydney, Australia collapsed in 1980, it appeared at first glance to be just another bank failure. But after Australian authorities began taking a closer look, they discovered a tangled web of intrigue with all the elements of a best-selling spy novel, a mysterious death, the body later dug up from its grave, illegal currency transactions, big-time drug operations, and the Central Intelligence Agency.
We were to become the paymasters for the CIA around the world. In other words, we were putting ourselves in the position to disperse funds for the CIA to whoever they were directed.
Former bank executive Neil Evans, given immunity from prosecution, agreed to talk about the Nugenhand operation on Australian television. From his account and others, the bank had its genesis during the Vietnam War. Four of the original stockholders were Americans who listed their addresses as Air America, Army Post Office, San Francisco. Air America was the CIA airline in Indochina, hauling men and supplies on clandestine missions, and according to former CIA agents, even drugs out of the so-called Golden Triangle, where the borders of Burma, Laos, and Thailand converge. Nugenhand sent Neil Evans to the Thai city of Chiang Mai, the commercial center of the drug trade. He claims the CIA made millions and used the money to finance some of its secret projects.
The idea was that money would be deposited with the Nugenhand Bank by the CIA through various channels, and also that the Nugenhand Bank would be the repository for funds coming in from various CIA enterprises, namely drugs in Thailand, marijuana in particular, and that the bank, the Nugenhand Bank, would then be responsible for rerouting that money to an account in America with a New York bank.
Nugent Hand was not your ordinary bank. There were secret numbered accounts, and hardly any of its top people were bankers. Many were American civilians and former high-ranking military officers with ties to U.S. intelligence. When they found the body of Australian businessman Frank Nugent, the bank's chairman, shot to death a few months before the bank went under, they discovered in his pocket the business card of this man, William Colby, former director of the CIA. Nugent's partner was Michael Hand, an American Green Beret, who served two tours in Vietnam, one of them for the Central Intelligence Agency. He disappeared a short while after the bank collapsed and is now believed to be dead. Australian newspapers reported a connection between Nugent Hand and the U.S. Navy's super-secret intelligence unit known as Task Force 157. Among its top agents, CIA man Edwin Wilson, now under indictment for selling arms and explosives to Libyan dictator Muammar Gaddafi. And a man named Patry Loomis has also been implicated. He was the apparent CIA Nugent Hand go-between. It was Loomis who helped Wilson recruit a team of Green Berets to train terrorists in Libya.
The Nugent Hand affair has caused an uproar in Australia, where authorities are trying to find out what involvement the bank might have had in the 1975 downfall of the Labour Party government. Meanwhile, investigators on three continents are attempting to trace $50 million missing from the accounts of depositors, including many Americans. Here in this country, the CIA denies any involvement with drug operations in Indochina, the Nugent Hand Bank itself, or the deaths of the two men who ran it. Gary Shepard, CBS News, Los Angeles.
In addition to the slush fund, the CIA created a series of forged documents implicating high-ranking members of the Labour Party in a succession of scandals. No hard evidence was ever produced to substantiate the allegations.
Do you think the new paper will have any political orientation like the Sun and its predecessor, the Daily Herald?
No fixed orientation in the sense that it will be allied to any party. Certainly not. It will be quite independent.
Fake letter bombs were posted to prominent Australians, including Queensland far-right wing premier Johannes Bjelke-Petersen. The Murdoch press concluded that extremists within the Labour Party had sent the letters. Once again, no evidence was provided. Eventually, a state of emergency was declared. Invoking the authority of the British Crown, Attorney General John Kerr dismissed Whitlam as Prime Minister.